I think in the future you will be able to follow education from other institutes while still being present in Wageningen and the other way around.
I think in the future the core of education will remain more or less the same. I do think that the campus will remain important, but that it will be more open. Society will come more to our campus and students will go more outside to society.
I believe case studies will be more important in future education, thereby coupling theory to practice. In this way, I hope students can be better prepared for their careers in future.
I think we will more value in the future the importance of informal parts of education. So the interactions with your fellow students, the interactions with your lecturers during coffee breaks, and being part of an academic community.
I envision education to empower people to become competent and responsible global citizens towards creating a more sustainable and inclusive future.
I think in 2030, there will be far more possible learning paths. You will be able to study like you do today, follow a program, 5 years. You will be able to do your study in modules and work in between, or to have a far more personalized program. And it will be more normal that you follow courses and partner institutes as well.
With the rise both in popularity and quality of massive online open courses, I expect students of all ages and backgrounds to pursue an online education.
For me, education is evolution, which means that we continuously adapt our education to change in society, demands from the particular field, and also change in behavior and attitude of students. So there's no real path to the future. There's continuously adaptation to changing environments and changing interests.
Distinguished colleagues, Mr. Mayor, representatives of 12 diplomatic representatives of 15 countries, Rectores Magnifici of other Dutch universities, members of the supervisory board, one present, the others online, students, all other guests, a warm welcome to this 104th Dies Natalis of Wageningen University and Research. You've seen just the theme of today's Dies Natalis, but I want to start in another way. I want to start with a message of peace. The military invasion of the Ukraine by the Russian Federation has touched us all very deeply. The war which is unfolding at the moment in the Ukraine also affects our partners in the Ukraine, partner institutions, and also the scientists which we work together with. As some of you have might been reading this morning, we have stopped all the international collaboration with Russia institutionally, but we allowed also individual scientists to continue their collaboration on an individual basis, especially those who also condemn the war in the Ukraine. We've also set up supporting systems for our students from the Ukraine and from Russia, from scientists which work here now from the Ukraine and Russia, but also for those refugees who come to us, to Wageningen, to enable them to study and work here also. We are in an unprecedented time, and it's very difficult to predict what the future will bring, but we know that it are historic moments we are going through. And it feels a little bit strange to now discuss indeed the future of education, but still we have to continue also our work. So education. Why education as a theme of a Dies Natalis? Of course, the first main reason is because it's our core business. Education, next to research and valorization, are the three main tasks of any university. It's also we do it because it has never been a topic at a Dies Natalis before, at least as far as I could read back. And of course, we also witness the impact of COVID on education, educational system, educational practices. And of course, we see strong debates on education, how education should take place, is taking place, and how it will take place in the future. And we have linked that to the theme of metamorphosis. And of course, some of you might think about, yeah, of course, that's typically Wageningen. Some will remember this picture from our strategic plan. Some others might think, okay, well, is he referring to the famous novel of Franz Kafka, who wrote a major book in the beginning of the 20th century? That was not really the thought of the commission who prepared this Dies Natalis. We were especially referring with Metamorphoses to the work of Ovid is called in English, who wrote in the year 8 after Christ a major poem, the Metamorphoses. And this poem chronicles the history of the world since its start up until the heydays of Julius Caesar. And the poem consists of 15 books, and it was a major inspiration of major writers such as Dante or Shakespeare. By the way, also, Ovid, Ovidius, didn't make it very long in the Roman Empire. He was expelled from Rome until really the outskirts, Romania now. And his statue, which is pictured here, is also from that location. Metamorphoses, Ovid wrote, is, and now I quote him, is something like this. Nothing keeps its own form. Nothing dies in the universe as a whole, but it varies and changes its aspects. And what we call being born is a beginning to be of something other than what was before. And dying is likewise ending a former stage. Or a little bit later in the 15th book, the last book of its poem, he writes very shortly, but it really captures what we meant with that. Everything changes, nothing dies. Of course, those of you in Wageningen who were raised here directly thinks, well, this is basically the first law of thermodynamics, avant la lettre. And indeed, he also refers to natural elements, fire, water, and all kinds of other natural elements, but also refer to social processes, social institutions, social structures in transformation, in changing constantly without really dying. And we took that idea of metamorphosis because often education, higher education, universities are seen as rather inert institutions. They are almost seen as innovation resistant. And we think that is not completely true. Here you see one example of how indeed university systems throughout, especially Europe here, has changed over time, starting with the first and oldest university, University of Bologna, established in 1088, throughout history. And here it's pictured in four different phases. The first phase of really a medieval university, where education was basically the only activity, usually on a very small scale, with very low technical teaching materials. Later on, around 1800, that was transformed into what we now call the Humboldt University, where next to education, but in close connection with education, research was added to a task for higher education institutions. And they also became major institutions, not small ones, but really large ones. A little bit later on, and then we are already in the 20th century, the universities start to really transform into much more modern institutions. Modern university, very monolithic still, really institutions centralized. But next to research and innovation, also the relations with society start to change. And valorization became really a major new idea, which is a task of a university. And at the moment, a lot of authors, and also the one who also made this distinction in the four phases, say that we are again in the transformation process of the university system towards much more flexible, open, networked, internationalized, digitalized, you name it, type of institutions. And between these different phases, you see a lot of differences, of course. Difference in the amount of students, in the didactics which are being practiced, in the contents of the education programs, were very different, in the learning materials, instruction languages, way of examination, the financing, state control or not control, or church control in the beginning even, etc., etc. So in that sense, there were a lot of differences in educational institutions. At the same time, we still call them universities. So there is something of an essence in that. And again, Ovid refers to that, to the soul of an institution. And so what is then the soul of a university education system? Well, basically the soul is, the essence is that we always have teachers. We always have students in that kind of institutions. We always have a kind of both passing knowledge, but also building of students. We always have examination and credentials. being worked there. We always work with different type of academic levels. We always have some kind of relation to experimentation and research. And there's always a system of quality assurance. What is now good education? What is good research? So in that sense, there is a lot of continuity also in universities. And that's why we call it also university still. That's looking backward, but also looking forward. Here you see that already very visionary, around 1900, some people predicted how the university system would look like, education systems would look like in 2000. At first you say, well, this is very strange and very queer. Of course, it's not like that. But if you think a little bit longer, of course, they didn't know about digitalization and wireless transformation of information. But the other things are quite already visionary. Indeed, we do no longer use books so much as we did before. And we transfer knowledge in a very different way, in an individualized way, much more than we did before. So that also calls the question, so what kind of visions do we now have on education of the future? And let's not go directly to 2100, but let's go for 10 years beyond that, 2030. How will education look like, higher education? And I start looking for that, but you hardly find any good pictures. So this is basically the best I could find in a kind of visionary day. And then people will say, I think you will also say, yeah, that's basically what is happening now already. Not full blown, but the use of VR, virtual reality spectacles in class, these kind of very alternative to for the blackboard, that's already practiced now. So it's not so easy to visualize how the future education system will look like. And the best, basically, I think what we can do at the moment is work with scenarios. And of course, we did that in Wageningen, which is also visualized here in 2017 in preparation of our strategic plan. And also all kind of other organizations made scenarios on what will be the future of higher education and higher education systems. But still, that is not very workable. So I think the best thing what we can do is look where are now the major changes taking place, where are the debates taking place. And of course, one of the first things what we see is in digitalization. So the digital revolution, if you want to call it, also affects higher education institutions and educational practices. It really forms the possibility of blended or hybrid education, which is now common practice, especially since COVID. It also gives us the possibility of new digital tools to work with. It gives the possibility of place-based as well as placeless education. It gives also all kind of new ways of learning analytics. So analyzing much more in detail how learning processes take place with students and feed that back into the learning process to improve that. And that comes again with all kind of debates and discussions on privacy. Can we do that? Who owns these kind of learning analytic data? We know that, but there's much more at stake in the debate on education. So a second main area is on didactics. Didactics are also changing rapidly. And also there are a lot of debates. On the one hand, massification of education. Think about the MOOCs, of course, where massive open online courses are being sent out widely throughout the world. And it's not strange that 100,000 students or learners follow that, versus personalization of education, where really we develop personalized learning paths in that sense. We see also all kind of different forms and modes of education taking place. Activated learning is part of our didactics. And we see all kind of different teaching materials emerging. A third main area where new things are happening and where we should look at is, of course, in the flexibility of learning. So we see a lot of mobility being possible these days of students who do no longer have to study at one place for 3 or 5 years, bachelor and a master, or even further. They can be much more mobile and learn from all kinds of different institutions. We see also places learning becoming much more easy. They don't not even have to be mobile with their body, so to say. They can be mobile with clicking on a website of another university. We see also all kind of developments beyond degrees. So is degrees, a master degree, a PhD degree, a bachelor degree, is that becoming old-fashioned or not? Will we in 10 years' time have no longer those degrees? And lifelong learning, of course, is also part of that flexibility of learning and learning path. Fourth main area where you see a lot of differences taking place is also on the content of and the learning outcomes of education. So there we see a lot of debates taking place on the balance between transferring knowledge, transferring skills or learning skills, and the traditional building. What is a good balance between those three areas? Are we moving away from cognitive learning towards much more skills and building processes? We see also a lot of changes in the labor markets and the requirements from the labor markets. How do we adapt to that in our contents of our learning processes? We see also a lot of discussion taking place on disciplines versus interdisciplines or even challenge-based learning processes. A fifth area where we see a lot of debate and changes taking place is the one between public and private. That goes, for instance, in discussions on accessibility of students and equal opportunity of students to universities and higher education systems. It also goes around the idea of private universities. Do we like that? Do we think that universities should remain public? What is the place for private universities in that sense? And it comes also with all kinds of financing and business models of universities. Sixth, we see a lot of changes taking place in the area of globalization versus localization, or nationalism, you could say. So there's, of course, a global battle of talent going on. So the fact that we have so many students from different countries, but also so many staff from different countries in our institutions, and we like to have them also, is a sign of really a global institution taking place and global education processes. But we see also that debate taking place in the language of instruction and the culture, which is also transferred via educational processes, where sometimes national governments press very hard for a much more national orientation, why some of the universities would rather have it really in a transnational or global way. We see it also taking place in terms of security, knowledge security, security of educational processes, and we know all the examples of that. And we see it also in discussions on hubs. Do education universities still have to stay at one place? Is Wageningen University a national university, or should it also establish hubs in all kinds of other places of the world and become really a global institution? And finally, the last era where we see changes is also on the university as an institution. So we see a plurality or a diversity of organizational models of universities taking place and discussions on what are the best ones. Should we see them really as monolithic institutions, or should we think them of part of ecosystems or of networks or of alliances, as we would rather call them? Also the idea of, do we still have in 10 years' times really universities, or are we approaching the end of the universities, which of course would reverse the start of with Ovid, that nothing dies, and then really the university as a system would die. But of course education will remain. And of course, we see also these kind of debates on the demarcation of a university versus other schooling system, especially in the Netherlands on the applied universities. Where is now an higher education as a university system, and where are we moving towards applied university system? Is it workable? Is it doable? Is it also desirable to have that distinction? I think we are here today to explore these kind of discussions and debates a little bit further. Not to give, of course, final answers, but really to see where are we heading to? What are major trends? And not only trends, but also what do we like? What do we desire? How do we want our university, Wageningen University, to look like as an education system? What is the type of education what we want to do? You saw also a lot of uncertainties there, and we are extremely happy that for that reason we can call upon experts. And we have one of the best experts in the world amongst us today, Professor Dirk van Damme. And I'm very happy that you accepted our invitation to lecture here on the future of higher education. And Dirk van Damme, ladies and gentlemen, is really an expert who worked in various academic positions. But I think most notably, he was a former head now of the higher education unit at the OECD. And at the moment, he still works very actively, also as a consultant, but also, I think most especially, as a senior research fellow at the Center for Curriculum Design, Redesign, which is really a kind of spin-off of Harvard University. So without further ado, I would like to invite you to the floor, Professor van Damme, and listen to your definitely wise words. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rector, for these warm words of welcome and appreciation. It remains to be seen whether I will be able to fulfill your expectations. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's indeed a real honor and a great pleasure, for which I thank the Rector and the Executive Board to speak at this wonderful Dies Natalis celebration of Wageningen University and Research. How do we see the future of universities? And I will elaborate a little bit more on some of the questions that you have raised to us before. Can we speak about relative stability, about continuous change, or do we see signs of acceleration of more fundamental transformation? Let me start with a reassuring and quite optimistic note. No, universities will not disappear. They are one of the most resilient institutions that human civilization has invented. And there is very little indication that their existence is under, that their existence is under existential threat. In 2030, 40, 50 and beyond, we will see universities flourishing all over the globe. But the word resilient does not mean conservatism, does not mean stubbornness. It signifies integrating continuity and change. Being resilient also means being flexible to adjust to changing circumstances. So the question becomes whether universities have the resilience to avoid stagnation, and the risk is real, and to open up to new challenges. Universities have a specific relationship with time, unlike most other institutions of the modern world. The origins of accumulated scientific knowledge, which universities have to transmit to new generations, go back to the earliest stages of human civilization. At the same time, universities produce new knowledge, and at an ever faster rate today. And this new knowledge helps to construct a better future for humanity, and new generations are educated for a lifetime in a rapidly changing world. Universities deal with a very long time horizon. So what is rapid change for a university is slow change for a society. The illustrious Clark Kerr, former president of the University of California in the United States and one of the greatest experts, far greater than I am, on universities, said in 1992 in his seminal, The Uses of the University, there are about 85 institutions in the modern world which have been established by the year 1520, which still exist today, including the Catholic Church, the parliaments of the Isle of Man, of Iceland and Great Britain, a couple of Swiss cantons, and 70 universities. So sudden changes at the surface of history look rather trivial in a long-term perspective. But universities do have to deal with more fundamental changes, often under the surface, which require them to transition to a new stage or even to transform more radically. The beautiful word metamorphosis expresses this notion of change very well, and I believe that we are in the midst of such a period. It's fair to say that the origins of those changes often lie outside universities. Universities do not change easily out of themselves. They change because they have to adapt to new circumstances. There is nothing wrong with that. The real power of universities is that they are able, like no other institution, to engage in reflective change, to analyze the changing environment, and who is better in doing that than universities, with the tools of scientific research and to balance the choices reflectively. So we are not speaking about disruption. I hate the word disruption. It comes from the fashionable, overused, and misused word coming from industrial innovation. No, we are talking about reflective change. But I do believe that we are in the midst of such a transformational period. In the history of universities, there are long periods of relative stability and periods of acceleration. And when situated amid such a change, it is difficult to predict the outcomes and to forecast the future. Yet we can see some glimpses of change of the future with high probability. Our current model of university education, and I follow a little bit a different timeline, has been shaped in the previous period of transformation, which stretched from the end of the Second World War well into the 1970s. And universities exchanged the old paradigm of elite education for a model which was oriented, and I have listed the characteristics here on the slide, human capital development for economic growth, for prosperity and for social progress, massification by opening access, credentialism for a qualifications-based labor market, social mobility through meritocracy, a front-loaded educational life course model, I mean front-loaded concentrating all education investments in the first quarter of a lifetime, and discipline-focused education for a rather stable occupational structure. I think those are the characteristics of the model that we have inherited today. And the merits of that model are huge. We cannot underestimate the contribution that universities have made to present-day prosperity, to well-being of the whole nations. We would not have the world today that we know without universities. Adapting to this model required a lot of effort from universities, especially massification has been, and still is, a difficult nut to crack. Governments rely on a funding model which implicitly rewarded the marginal cost of every additional student, but marginal cost in a university reality is a fictitious concept. This tension could only be solved by stretching institutional capacity, and that has been the main challenge in the past decades, maximizing the workload of staff. Not all promises of the model have been fulfilled. It was founded on a beautiful but overly ambitious concept of equality of opportunity. University education should be available and accessible for everyone with the necessary capabilities, whatever his or her social background, social status, gender, the color of skin, religious affiliation, etc. And despite all our good intentions, and many people have done their utmost best in realizing equality of opportunity, we did not succeed. Social background still matters for success in higher education, directly or via the impact on prior educational trajectories. Successful university is not education is not only a matter of universal access, but also of deep-rooted structural social inequality and sometimes even real discrimination. Massification has lifted the distribution of educational success, but did not reduce the width of the distribution. These data here are average for all OECD countries, and you see that actually the gap has slightly increased between students with parents with a higher education and parents with a low educational attainment. It is not only in international politics and diplomacy, or in welfare state policy, that the post-war consensus is falling apart. It also falls apart in higher education. There are cracks in the current model through which the light of a new and promising model starts to shine, to quote Leonard Cohen. It would take me too long to analyze all of these cracks, and actually I'm writing a book on this, but let me focus on a couple of them. First of all, credentialism is definitely on the decline. Maybe not in all countries, especially in emerging economies, credentials, degrees, qualifications still have a lot of value. But in a couple of countries, diplomas and degrees are less and less valued by employers. A good indication is, there is research about this, is a sharp decline in degree requirements for in job advertisements. More and more global employers no longer ask for a university degree for highly qualified labor. Second, massification is under pressure. More and more governments question whether we should infinitely increase the share of tertiary educated graduates in the population. And I myself, I was for a long time a believer in ever more people going to university. I don't believe today anymore. At the individual level, university education still yields benefits in earnings, social status, and many other outcomes. Yet, at a societal level, there are strong signs of overschooling, degree inflation, diminishing economic returns, and substitution effects against mid-educated workers. Of course, universities have an interest in higher student numbers, but society does not necessarily have an interest. Or our societies do not need ever more university graduates to prosper and innovate. Like countries such as Germany, Switzerland, and others realize, we also need well-trained, mid-educated technicians and professionals. And we need to avoid substituting those mid-educated people with highly educated but overschooled people. There are strong concerns about the impact of university education on social inequality and meritocracy. The production of high numbers of university graduates has contributed to polarization on labor markets, and that's very documented these days also in the work of the OECD. Squeezing out the middle class, giving rise to social inequality, threatening social cohesion, social stability, and our political democracy. Universities should critically reflect on their role in growing social inequality and social polarization. Next, the front-loaded model of the educational life course, which concentrates educational investments in the first 25 years of an individual, creates the illusion that qualifications last a lifetime. It prevents a real breakthrough of lifelong learning. Our educational system contrasts with the real world of increasingly diversified and destandardized biographies. The idea that that the knowledge and skills which a degree represents remain valid for a lifetime of work is simply an illusion. And then finally, discipline-centric education is under a lot of pressure as well. Outside the realm of regulated professions, such as medical doctors or lawyers, there is less and less congruence between scientific disciplines and the occupational structure. New occupations, new professions, often emerging at the frontiers of disciplines, where also new scientific research findings are situated, no longer relate clearly to the disciplines. So, in short, there are strong doubts that university education is still preparing people for jobs. Of course, this probably exaggerated picture and very schematic picture would require a lot of nuance. And especially for technical universities, I have to bring a lot of nuance myself because they are facing an enduring problem of undersupply of the qualified STEM workforce for a knowledge-intensive and innovative economy and society. So please don't take my plea for less students at your own heart. We need more STEM graduates in our societies. But you will forgive me for painting the big picture with very large brush strokes. What are then the characteristics of the emerging model, and what are the consequences for university education? First, the new model will be about skills. And the word has already been mentioned by the rector. The new model will not be about qualifications or credentials. Credentials are so 20th century. Skills are labeled the new currency. And indeed, the turn to skills is real and very strong. And I'm afraid that universities still fail to see it. For me, the word skill is not synonymous with vocational characteristics. There is a huge debate needed, and I call upon universities to start a debate what specifically are academic skills. OECD data, such as collected in the survey of adult skills, point to an important discrepancy between qualifications and skills. Too many graduates enter the labor market with high qualifications but poor skills. Even in the Bologna space, the same qualification does not have a similar skills equivalent. Universities are hesitant to embrace skills which are seen as vocational, whereas, as I said, there is a huge need for an academic definition of skills. Qualifications are rapidly losing their significance as a reliable measure of the skills which employers value. And this is a risky development, a very risky development for universities. There are strong signs, as this quote illustrates, especially in economies with more open labor markets, such as the United States or Australia, that employers no longer trust the signaling value of qualifications, and they start to move to skill assessment themselves. There is no business as rapidly growing than the assessment business, where institutions, organizations start to assess students and no longer trusting the assessment by universities. Also, the rapid expansion of alternative qualifications, often driven by corporate interests and explicitly vocational oriented, such as micro-credentials, digital badges, nano-degrees, is part of this trend. Employers seem to value a skill-focused certificate more than a university degree. Second, the new model is about new skill demand. I know there is a lot of rhetoric about so-called 21st century skills, but there is a real change happening in the demand for skills as a consequence of digitalization, automation, and artificial intelligence. Routine tasks are disappearing very rapidly in the task input of jobs. And this is a change which is taking place, which has never been taking place so drastically on our labor markets. Higher education, though, is still predominantly focused on training young people for predictable, procedural tasks. There is growing frustration among global employers that universities are not adjusting their curricula and teaching and learning environments to address the need for creativity, problem solving, communication, and critical thinking skills. Unfortunately, we don't have a PISA for higher education because it was blocked. It was one of my greatest disappointments while working at UECD. It was blocked because of the concerted resistance of universities all over the world. They didn't want a PISA for higher education. But the recent assessment of critical thinking skills of university graduates in a number of countries, including Finland, demonstrated that only half of them had the advanced critical thinking proficiency required for the job reality. And the value added between the first and the third year of a bachelor's degree was minimal. If you are interested, I'm finishing a book on this, an OECD book, which will be published end of June. Third, the new model asks for an innovative redesign of curricula and learning trajectories. There is indeed a lot of confusion about interdisciplinarity, which has become a very fashionable word. And this often leads to a superficial mingling of different disciplinary content. But there are also interesting experiences, for example, in the university colleges in this country, to develop new blends of disciplines. In the international discussion, there is an emerging consensus that there is nothing wrong with disciplinary knowledge. The time has passed that interdisciplinarity meant no disciplinary knowledge. A university graduate has to develop a deep knowledge of a particular domain. But on top of that, his horizontal capacity geared towards the development of transferable generic skills has to be built. And that's the huge educational challenge with which universities are confronted. This is called the T-shaped model, and it is gaining a lot of traction in the international discussion. It requires Yes, besides deep disciplinary knowledge, the development of metacognition and the capacity for transfer and synthesis. Especially in a context of artificial intelligence, we need a massive effort for curriculum redesign in this direction. Fourth, the new model will be embracing, finally, lifelong learning. The Netherlands, as well as my own country, concentrate their university education investments on the traditional age cohort, entering university at the age of 18. In this country, only 5% of first-time entrants into universities are over the age of 25. And you see where the Netherlands and my own country, Belgium, is situated in this chart of OECD countries. Regulation is working against part-time study and against new combinations of work and study. Whereas society is moving in the direction of diversification of biographies and the economy is asking for more flexible lifelong learning with opportunities for reskilling and upskilling along the life course, university education still enforces an outdated model of front-loaded education, of which the qualification is supposed to last a lifetime full of change. This is not sustainable. Skill depreciation is real. The half-lifetime of skills is shortening at a very rapid pace. And after half a century of empty rhetoric about lifelong learning, digitalization is radically changing the learning biographies and requires us to address this challenge finally. We need shorter initial education with more flexible combinations of part-time study and work at later stages of the life course. In the highly diversified and flexible environment of lifelong learning, universities no longer will have the monopoly. And there is a huge need for innovative approaches for universities to play a significant role in this market. And believe me, universities are missing the train of lifelong learning, and others are sitting in the seats where you should be sitting. Apart from the rather narrow and specifically tailored programs offered by other providers, universities have to retain an important place in the domain of research-based education. It is not because it's lifelong learning that it has to be purely vocational. There is a lot of need for academic lifelong learning. But it will be more and more in a network educational arrangement, working with others, working with companies, with other providers. An active role of universities in post-initial lifelong learning will be critically important for the survival of universities. The idea that a research-based education is something for the initial phase and that lifelong learning is about more targeted vocational training is simply very, very wrong. Finally, the new model will be about a diversified teaching and learning landscape. The pandemic has accelerated the development of distance education, online learning, and hybrid approaches. And this is good. This required a very steep learning curve for university teachers, support staff, technical support units. The question now is how to benefit from this experience to design the teaching and learning environment of the future and not to fall in the trap of going back to the old normal as nothing has happened. The experience with online learning has not been overwhelmingly positive. Research has indicated quite a lot of negative outcomes. And students seem to value traditional formats, such as in-person, campus-based lectures and seminars. In other countries, universities have openly questioned whether they should continue to pay huge fees for poor online education. Recent research seems to indicate that self-directed and activating learning approaches, which have been very fashionable in the past years, they fail to produce equivalent learning outcomes than cognitively demanding lectures and seminars. So the picture is mixed. Some very fashionable developments are on the decline. The future is about diversification and the smart design of hybrid and complicated teaching and learning delivery modes, combining synchronous and asynchronous, online and on-campus, digital and in-person teaching and learning, using those methodologies and approaches which make the best results, produce the best results. It will require a lot of ingenuity of university teachers and universities to design the smartest and most effective approaches. But there are a lot of lessons to be learned from the experiences during the past pandemic. I think it's the duty of universities to systematically reflect on what has happened in their own business over the past 2 years. The Netherlands have been very successful in developing a high-quality university education system. But it happened under the old paradigm. An accessible, high-quality system with high output for a relatively low cost. Will the country suffer from Jan Romain's famous law, and I know the English translation is not perfect, law of the handicap of the head start, meaning that high performance in the old model is limiting the capacity to switch to the new model? I think this risk is real. But that would be an underestimation of the reflective capacity and strength of innovation of the Dutch system. It is essential that the system fosters its capacity for analysis, for research, for reflection, and for change management. Moving from the old to the new never is straightforward. It's often messy and difficult, and much is still unclear. But as this meeting demonstrates, the willingness to change is there, and I have to congratulate Wageningen University and the research. I'm quite impressed with what I have seen also in the documents, that it takes this reflection on the future of higher education very seriously, and that it engages in a lot of innovation. Let me conclude with some thoughts on what the rector started with, what is happening today on our European continent and what keeps us busy and awake at night, the war in Ukraine. Whatever the outcome in the short term, the medium and long term consequences will be huge, also for education and research. The world is moving to a multipolar reality with large states dominating so-called spheres of influence. What is going to be decisive then for these polars in the world? What is going to be critically important for global success and impact? I believe it will be education, research, and innovation. We already see the importance of technology in the ongoing conflict. I simply do not believe that a system which is not valuing the free flow of ideas, the education of critical citizens, of academic freedom, of fundamental research, of open innovation has any chance to foster long-term economic success, prosperity for its citizens, and a bright future for its children. I truly believe that this is at stake in Ukraine. Beyond the tragedy that is evolving before our eyes, this is the challenge that we have to address. Thank you so much for your attention, and I wish Wageningen University and research a flourishing future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Van Damme, for your inspiring words, helping us with your wisdom, and also giving us some hope that reflection will make things better. We really thank you for being with us, and we also will ever remember your wise words on the terrible situation in Ukraine. Thank you very much for that. And now, ladies and gentlemen, something a little bit different. I would almost say completely different, but then you think of Monty Python, of course, and that's not the idea. I want to introduce you to you, Michiel Borslap. Michiel Borslap is a famous Dutch piano player, and he played with all kinds of classical musicians, such as Janine Jansen, Lavina Meyer, and also Ludovico Einaudi. He was a soloist player at the Radio Philharmonic Orchestra and the Dutch Metropole Orchestra. And we have him today in our midst, and he will play a piano improvisation on the theme of, what else, Metamorphoses. Michiel Borslap. Thank you.
Michiel, thank you very much. Can I have one big applause again for Michiel? I don't know why, but it made me think about my children. I don't know what you guys thought. My name is Karim Amghar, and I'm here today, your host for the talk show that we are going to do in a few minutes. It's in line with Rector Magnificus told us about change in education, but also about inequality, also about innovation and everything that connects to it. But before we're going to do that, I want to do one little thing with you guys, because as a presenter, as a host, as a TV and radio host for a national broadcaster, I love to talk about myself, but I want to get to know you guys a little bit. And I want to do that by telling a little bit about myself, and if that affects also on you, I want to ask you to stand up. So my first question is, stand up if you have children. We need a little bit energy in the room. Thank you. You can sit again. Free movement. Stand up if you love soccer. Like soccer, love soccer, football. And if you like, and if you're a fan of Feyenoord.
Hey,
Rotterdam represented, but I'm from Blijswijk, so that's... stand up if you love education. So it's a good time for the Rector Magnificus to check who sits down of his colleagues. Thank you. Stand up if you were born in Holland. Stand up if you were born in Holland. Check. Stand up if you, not in my case, work for the Wageningen University, so I can know who works for the Wageningen University. A lot of other people. Thank you very much. Again, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for having me here today. As much as I like to talk about myself, I'm going to do a talk show with four very inspiring people. And I'm going to do that about innovation of education, but also about the corona virus period and how our education is looking in the future. That is with Christine Bok, Innovation Manager of Education at SURF, with Derek Loorbach, Professor of Socioeconomic Transitions and the Director of Drift at the Erasmus University of Rotterdam. Julia Diederen, Teacher, Laboratory of Food Chemistry, here at the Wageningen University and Research, as we say in Dutch, a thuiswedstrijd, a home game, such as Tamkien Heidier, and she's a student, a master student of environmental sciences at the Wageningen University. A big applause for these four panel members. Yeah. I ordered four beautiful white couches.
We'll take it here.
Yeah. Yes.
But
yeah,
you're so far away.
Oh, yeah. I'll come close.
COVID, eh? as you know, education, and also here at the university, we do everything for the students. So it's obvious that we start with you, Tamkien. How are you?
Doing great.
How were the past 2 years for you, educational-wise?
I would like to say that it had been quite isolating. Given the corona situation, students had to stay back in their 12 square meters, although online education has been quite adaptive in helping students get that content at home, at that flexibility. We did miss out on a lot of the little interactions you would have with your friends, your teachers when you would go grab a cup of coffee, for example. Mm.
And how did you do that with your classmates? Did you have contact with them through Teams or WhatsApp or otherwise?
Yes, it was a lot of informal contact. So you have had WhatsApp groups. You also made use of Microsoft Teams, for example. But it was also advised by teachers
to do it
as well. Yeah.
And was it a difficult period for you?
Luckily for me, I was not following any courses. but from what I've heard, yes, it had been quite difficult for us.
And Julia, you are a teacher at the Wageningen University. How was it for you from a perspective as a teacher?
It were challenging times, of course, especially about 2 years ago, this day, that we heard that Monday, when the new period starts, it had to go online. Mm. And that was a very sudden change. So that was, I think, very stressful. But yeah, that's 2 years ago. I think in the meantime, we have learned a lot. So many teachers have learned to use all kinds of tools. They have developed new educational activities. So on one hand, it was very stressful. I think on the other hand, we've learned a lot.
And are you now more happy, or do you miss the times that you could give your courses online?
No.
You don't miss that?
No.
You love the interaction?
No, I don't. Of course. Yeah, I think I can speak for all teachers that education is about interaction. And I don't say that interaction cannot be done online. It can. And that is what we have learned, I think. A lot of interaction can be done online. But that's not all. Mm. More needs to take place. So the informal interaction that was missing. Mm-hmm. Between students and between students and teachers.
Exactly. And just as you, I am a teacher as well. And normally I would say, everybody put your phone in your pocket, but I'm going to ask everybody to grab their phones because we want to talk with you, but also with all the people at home, and to go to menti.com and fill out, I hope that it's behind me, the code, because we want to interact with you guys with the question: the COVID-19 period has learned us that we cannot maintain current teaching and learning methods. These are simply too vulnerable. Dirk, what was the COVID-19 situation learned us?
I think that's something that is for historians in the future, because we're still in the midst of it. I think one of the things it showed us is how resilient we are indeed. So the example you gave, I remember the first days, and basically everything had to change overnight. And that's an experience that is very valuable, I think. And Professor Van Damme said, I hate the word disruption. Mm-hmm. Normally, I also say it's people use it that haven't been paying attention, but in this case, it was a disruptive event. And I hope it taught us the lesson that we need to think more proactively about expected surprises, potential disruptions, to build in resilience. And I think the teachers that most successfully dealt with the disruption were the ones that were already experimenting before COVID with new tools, new measures, innovating in the classroom. So the experimental have an advantage in times of crisis and transformation.
And Julia, was it completely new for you?
You mean online?
Giving your lessons online?
No, not at all. So I completely agree. In our group, Food Chemistry, we were already experimenting with online education for a long time, since 2000. So we had a lot of online learning activities already there, and we were already using them before in our classrooms. So to make the change was not a big change.
No. Yeah. And Dirk, you say we are still in the midst of it. It's for the researchers of the future to say, how was it? Do you also imply that there's a big possibility, not that I'm asking you as an expert on COVID, but are you already thinking about maybe in the future we get another lockdown again?
No, not like that. It's not that simple. So, from a complexity perspective, we build in vulnerability by decreasing diversity. So, the history of higher education that was sketched and the massification, that also meant we become more vulnerable for disturbances or changes in our environment. So it might come from different directions, and now we are talking about war in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. That was an expected surprise. But what the effects are and how we cope with it, that is something that we don't know, and we don't see the whole picture. Mm. So the attention should be about building resilience and diversity and experimenting, reading these macro signals that were also mentioned by Professor van Damme. Mm. We see the kind of direction of change, and we might start to think about where we want to be at in the future and create much more space and reward systems for the ones that are already experimenting. Mm.
Christine, you and Dirk and a lot of other people worked on the acceleration agenda for innovation. What are the important results that came out of it? What next steps do you expect in the upcoming few years?
Well, I think in the Netherlands we are quite ahead on innovation of education. And there's a lot of expertise already, but the big change in education has still to happen. So I think we are in a real good position in the Netherlands because we are so connected to each other. And we really collaborate and we really learn from each other and experiment together. So I think this is a great time to take next steps for transformation of education.
Yeah. Could you give us a little bit more of detail of what that acceleration agenda of innovation was and is?
Well, the acceleration agenda started before COVID, and was aimed of really changing things within the institutions, and knowing together what is needed for the change. So the institutions together experiment and say, well, this is what we need technically, for example, IT services, etc. And so we develop them together so that as a country, as a whole, we can use the tools that are developed by small groups of universities.
Yeah, and you say in Holland we are doing good at as it is about innovation. Are there other countries that you're looking at, of you guys are looking at that are doing great job at that innovation?
I'm not completely sure that we're doing well. I think we're
doing
we're doing well in terms of innovation, but not in terms of system change. And talking from my own university in Rotterdam, I think there's a lot of great teachers and experimentation going on, but there's also a lot of inertia built into the educational system, and that comes with the massification, but also with what education is. Teachers also stop learning at a certain point, but it's also how it is organized institutionally. And what was mentioned briefly is the content of the education. So a lot of the education in Rotterdam, at least, is knowledge from the past that doesn't work for the future. And we are not so advanced in finding a way to make that really adaptive or reflexive. Mm-hmm. So the experiments, yes, but the scaling them up and in the institutional change and how to organize that, that's a more challenging thing.
Is it also that we are talking about it from a student perspective, a lifelong learning? Is it also implied for the teachers, for if you're talking about innovation?
Well, I think that new models, but you might know better, is it where the teacher is the learner and vice versa. So it's about knowledge co-creation. It's about asking the right questions and trying to figure out what are plausible answers in the current context.
Yeah.
And obviously teachers have more experience on methods and on tools and where to find knowledge, but fresh eyes always ask the most interesting questions.
Yeah, and you as a student, Tamkin, if you're listening to the subjects that passed the review, what are the needs for students if you're talking about the future of education? If you're looking at it from a student perspective, what are your needs?
Mm. I think some of the problems that students have mentioned in the past few years due to COVID were, for example, social interaction. That cannot be eliminated from education, as far as I can see.
Mm. So completely online is not an option?
I would say not, yeah. But besides that, there are also other gaps that we need to fulfill. The current system, how it works, how efficient is it for students? And I think addressing those changes need to be there while you're trying to innovate education. Mm.
And again, for the audience and also at home, I want to check with you the next Mentimeter. So that's the future of the Wageningen University and research education programs will be much more flexible than they are now. What will future education programs look like, Christine? Will learners follow an entire program or just parts of it?
Well, I think what will be strong is that you have the choice between following a program and making up your own program. So the flexibility will be the strongest point in, the way you want to create your own curriculum or follow a curriculum that is designed by a university.
And are there universities in Holland right now that are playing with that idea? Just
yes.
Like some, I would think about a phone with some apps and you design your own phone and after it, it's your designed phone?
Your designed
curriculum. Are there universities working like that?
Well, in some ways, I think Wageningen University is in a very good working on flexibility in the curriculum, yes, and encouraging student mobility.
And is that still on a basis like, okay, you have to do these parts to get a diploma or a certificate? Or is it just like, I want to follow these courses because I need them for my job or the future of my job?
I think that is the way where we are going. That is what Dirk van Damme also said, of course, that our curriculums are not preparing us for the labor market in the way that we might think they are. Mm. And I think the strongest part of flexibility is that students can follow their own path.
Yeah. Dirk, how do you think the future of education will be looking like? Is it diploma based, certificate based, or
that's looking into like a glass ball, but we can think about what we want.
Hypothesis as a researcher.
Well, to comment on the flexibility, I know Wageningen together with Eindhoven and Utrecht is working on this model where indeed, which is already partly there, that students can look at the list of courses of the different universities and then compose their own curriculum. But what it needs is a framework. Because obviously, if you can shop as a consumer, but there's also an educational quality that needs to be ensured and a vision that the universities can provide. So they provide the framework or the context within which the learner can choose its own learning path. So that's one. The second thing is that it will be much more hybrid between knowledge transfer and the capacities and the skills that were also mentioned. Mm. So because we are preparing for an uncertain future that requires experimentation basically on a societal scale. So we are facing challenges that we cannot know the answer for beforehand. So we have to change in all parts of our economy, and that requires an entrepreneurial attitude, a critical mindset, skills to collaborate across boundaries. So those kinds of capacities that's at the heart of it, combined with the ability to understand a complex issue. So that also requires the knowledge skills.
And are you saying that a construction worker in the future that needs or it's beneficial for him or for her to run a course here at the university, it is possible for him or her?
Now you're talking about educational levels.
Does it still matter what kind of educational level she or he has?
I think this is happening at all educational levels. So we had these conversations at the MBO level, but we also have within our university, we have all sorts of educational programs at primary and high school level. Mm. So I think the educational system as a whole is changing or metamorphing into a more hybrid, that it's not only about knowledge transfer, but it's about these skills and capacities that prepare you for life and complex jobs in any position.
But I can also think about a construction worker from MBO, let's say Niveau 4, who wants to follow a course here at the university, maybe do a test, and then can enroll if he or she wants. Yeah. Doesn't involve a diploma, maybe a certificate. Yeah.
I think, but you can maybe say more about it, but that's the international trend that's already happening, that the diplomas are worth less or valued less than certificates and specific skills.
This
or
is Mr. Van Damme just said. Yeah.
So depending on the job. So that also means that throughout your life, you people will shop for specific skills and knowledge elements.
But is it even possible for a teacher to have students from different kind of levels in your classroom?
I was throughout listening, I was thinking, ooh, how am I
difficult
going to deal
difficult
with such a diverse group, with such diversity in prior knowledge, prior skills, maybe also differences in age. If we're talking about a 40-year-old and an 18-year-old in the same course with different life skills as well. Okay.
But?
That's very challenging, yeah. I think, as a teacher, to then reach the quality that you want. I'm not sure.
We
need a huge change then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But impossible, Christine? Or possible?
Well, I'm not a teacher. so I think what is very important is that we make a distinguish between the content of education and the organization of education. And I think we really need to collaborate to make the organization of education flexible and have the teachers in charge of the content of education. And I totally agree that it will be very difficult, so we have to find out, does it work or doesn't it work? But if we are more flexible in how we can organize things, then we can find solutions for such questions.
Mm. Is it desirable for a student to from different kind of levels?
Well, I see Wageningen as a melting pot of multicultures, different identities, different individuals with lots of talent, lots of intelligent and creative heads, and learning where these students come from, or be it the truck driver that you mentioned. I think we can tap onto those spots and really get to know, okay, these are my students who do require a bit more support from me. I will give it a bit more hands-on push. Mm. I think students would like that. And for now, as you already mentioned, that the framework exists. So students, what would they like to follow to get into the career that they would desire? However, are we doing enough to students think for themselves, why are they wanting that? Mm. And how are they going to get that? I think it's most of the whys and the hows that are missing in the current system.
And when I was listening to Mr. Van Damme, he also talked about the role as physically as a university. And he started with, rest assured, universities will be there. And the quote was on the screen and people were laughing and were happy and stuff like that. Because also fear kicks in when something changes. Are you afraid as a teacher, or maybe the future of being a teacher will change when you are listening to all the difficult and different kind of innovation?
I'm not afraid. But when I listen to the speech of Van Damme, then I think, oh my, we have a lot of work to do in the coming 20 years. I don't think in 10 years' time it will change drastically.
But I also see the point of changing, and we are already starting with that, especially when it comes to skills development. The last 3 years, I think we are already thinking and also already designing learning activities to increase skill development in courses. But we are really at the start of that, and there are great educational theories that can help us improve our education, but we're not there yet. Mm. Yeah. So afraid not, but yeah, there is a lot of work to be done.
Yeah. And Dirk, you work a lot on that change. You talk with people from different kind of educational levels. Is there a lot of fear? If you're talking about innovation, change,
well, the interesting thing about the emotions, the mixed emotions in the context of societal transitions is that they are mixed. So there are people that get excited by it, that think, okay, let's do it, and okay, it's a challenge, but I see the possibilities. For a lot of people, only the thought of change already is threatening or discomforting or problematic. And I think I really like the theme chosen for today, because ultimately, these big changes on the long term are very evolutionary on the short term. And as long as we are able to collectively sort of reflect on where we want to go on the long term, be critical about where we want to move away from or what is not working anymore in the current context, that creates a space for experimentation. And then you make change much less scary, but also discomforting. Yeah.
Yeah.
But obviously, it is also
it's always scary. It's always difficult. It's always
and also
exciting.
Great friction. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. The third Mentimeter. You will see it behind me on the screen. Let me check if it's working. That is, the future of the Wageningen University education and the role of its teachers will be radically different from what it looks now. What do you think, Christine, if you look at this this statement?
I think it's a
difficult question.
It's a difficult question for me. I look at it from an IT perspective, and I think that if we really collaborate on a common national IT infrastructure, we have so much opportunities to really change education and to help teachers to focus on the content of education. So to really have the role in what you say you like to be personalized, coached, and that's the time to do that. I think we have a great opportunity if we really collaborate to do so.
So it's possible to personally, emotionally coach a student also from an IT perspective. Online or maybe in some kind of VR world?
Well, you can use IT for coaching, but you also can arrange things with IT so that the teacher gets more time to just have personal contact.
Effectively help
just,
the
just,
student.
Just not even with IT, but just here sitting on the couch.
And helping each other.
Yeah.
What do you think, Tamkir? Will it radically change also the way as you are a student?
Interesting.
Very difficult question.
Yeah, I compare where I come from and I compare Wageningen University and...
Where do you come from?
Bangladesh. Back home, education works actually more hands-on and it's more theoretical compared to here. It's more of the tacit knowledge that you pick up with these small social interactions. And in ways it works, because it does teach you to be independent, it does work in favor for you to go into your career. However, if you look into each individual student, of course, not everybody fits into the same box. With the help of IT, I hope we can personalize these pathways for students in the future.
And is the current education system robust enough to deal with current developments, Dirk? Do we need a radical overhaul, or do we expect small changes in the future? We are talking about changing the system. It's difficult to look at that future ball, but from hypothesis perspective, do you think it's going to be a radical change, or just a few small changes?
Yeah, I define radical. So what we say about transitions, it's radical change on the long term and very incremental on the short term. So it's really in the eye of the beholder, because ideally we will see a radical change in how knowledge is made available, how knowledge is exchanged, how we change the pace at which new knowledge becomes available to learners, while at the same time the student-teacher dynamic is maybe a bit going back to what it was, smaller scale, more personal interaction. So then what is radical? But if you look at the whole system and sort of the historical trends, I think it for me, there's no doubt that in 20 years we will have a completely different educational landscape and how it's organized and how we think about the value and the role of higher education. Mm-hmm.
I want to thank you all very, very much for your time and your knowledge, and also the rector and Dirk van Damme, and especially for his words on the inequality of chances in education. I make documentaries for TV, also a documentary about inequality of education. I wrote a book about it, also some marketing from my side. The book Hoor Mij, Zie Mij, and it is a big problem, and I hope that we can tackle it all together, but because this is a big crowd that's difficult for me to reach if it's about the topic of equality of chances in education. I want to thank you all very much. I've learned a lot. I hope you as well, and also at home. And a big applause for all the guests. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karim. The four panelists, Dirk, Tamkin, Julia, and Christine, for enlightening us on this team. Now we move to a topic which is getting close to the end, of course, is the handing out an award. We have established a new award, the Education Innovation Award. And a jury, an expert jury, headed by Perry van den Broek, our professor in Education and Learning Sciences, have been looking at all the applications. More than 60 nominations have been put forward for this new award. And they looked at it very carefully. We're impressed by all the applications for that. They varied widely in different types of innovations in education. And of course, as always, there's one winner for that. And the winner is a course which is entitled Transformative Research for Global Social, Economic, Environmental Challenges. And it was a course which is coordinated by the Forest and Nature Conservation Policy Group with active participation of more than 22 lecturers from all our five departments in Wageningen, as well as international partners from other institutions. There are two, we don't have all the 22 members, of course, here to hand out the prize, but we have two of them. Can I ask to the floor Josie Chambers and Jeanne Nel to come to the floor? Let me first read a little bit what the jury thought of this course. Now I quote the jury report, of course. The winning innovation is seen as successful and valued by students, teachers, and other stakeholders. It is open to a variety of learners, master's students, as well as PhDs and also postdocs. It includes innovations in teaching methods, such as art-based methods, critical listening, and serious games. It also allows students to show their learning outcomes in innovative ways, such as role play, theater act, music, or poems. It is an innovation in the true WUR spirit of finding answers together. It brings together expertise from different domains, from different experts within and outside of academia, and from different students and teachers. Well, that's a very nice jury report. And now, I want to have this prize to hand out. Thanks very much. It's a new, don't ask me to say what it is. It is art, and it has an inscription for that. And of course, it comes also with a money to be spent for innovation. Who can I give it to? To you?
I guess to everyone, yeah.
Great. Thank you so much, everyone. It's really an honor to be here with all of you and to accept this award also on behalf of everyone who was involved in this course. And just to give a bit of a backstory, this course emerged from a year-long process across WUR that explored the question, how can research be more transformative for society? And Esther Turnout, just in front of me, and Jean Nell and I, we identified four main ways of working to pluralize, empower, politicize, and embed research with society, which this formed the basis for our course, which we designed together. And we haven't been given the time to mention the 22 and the many people involved by name, but we want to recognize WEMEC and especially Peter Vermeulen, who's also in front of me, for hosting the course. We want to recognize Maria Tango from the Stockholm Resilience Center for co-organizing it. And of course, the 21 lecturers, mostly from WUR, who are at the forefront of education innovation on transformative learning, justice, power, emotions, and many other critical themes, and honestly are equally deserving of this award, which made it quite hard to accept. And we see this course as part of a growing movement that builds on sharp critique of how our own beliefs and methods constrain us and create space for a sense of possibility and hope for how we can try to do things differently by working together. And our 24 PhD candidates showed us that this is possible when we all show up with humility, wisdom, and humanity. And this kind of education is urgently needed across all facets of society to realize our collective potential, especially with those in positions of power, both outside of the university and inside of the university. And so we really look forward to expanding this course in the years to come. And I would love to invite first everyone who's been involved in this course. We have both participants in the room as well as some lecturers. I want to invite them to stand up so that we can also recognize everyone and also those who are online who played a fundamental role in this course. And great, thank you so much. And we really appreciate also that this award, how it looks, kind of represents our messy process of trying to discover new things together. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you, one big hand. Shall I take the mic, or it's not part of the... Okay, ladies and gentlemen, if you have followed the program correctly, you have seen that we've come to the end, but we have something in between as a kind of pre-dessert, if you would like so. An announcement by the executive board, and so I want to call to the floor our chair of the executive board, Luis Fresco, and also Francesco Gerasimo to come to the floor. They will do together an act. Maybe Francesco first sits down and then Luis starts.
Thank you very much, Arthur. Ladies and gentlemen, it's with great trepidation that I make this announcement. I'm very proud and honored to say that we've signed this afternoon a letter of intent, an LOI, to establish an Institute of Advanced Studies in Photosynthetic Efficiency. Now, this might sound somewhat strange to some of you because it sounds very, very upstream, very, very fundamental. But as Francesco will explain to you, this is of utmost importance. To create this institute, would not have been possible without a very generous gift by three individuals who want to remain unknown, although they are somewhere hidden in this audience. And they have decided to dedicate from their own personal funds a massive sum of 50 million euros over a decade. Thank you. Thank you. This is absolutely unprecedented in our history, and that's why you see me standing here. Moreover, the university itself has decided to match that to some extent within our means. So we're adding another 12.5 million over that same decade. That means that we have suddenly 62 million, a little bit over that, to dedicate to a subject which is really unique and of unique importance. And it's no coincidence that we have such a unique gesture in this university to such a unique subject. And those of you who remember that when I started 7.5 years ago at my first opening of the academic year, I said that the holy grail of our science is really photosynthesis. You may or may not remember that. I still believe that very, very strongly. So when I was asked for a subject for this huge amount of possibilities, I said within a moment, without hesitation, photosynthesis. Because photosynthesis is the most important process on Earth. Without photosynthesis, as you know, first-class biology, there would not be any life. There would be no oxygen. And it's only plants or plant-like autotrophs that are able to harness the sunlight and change CO2 from the air into glucose and oxygen. And that's why all of us are here. But now the interesting thing is that that process is extremely inefficient. It is so because sunlight is the only sustainable, unlimited resource we have on this planet. So evolutionarily speaking, there was never a reason for plants to become efficient. And hence, only 1% of the sunlight that reaches the Earth is actually transformed into something that other organisms, including us humans, can actually use. Raising that 1% to 5 or 6%, so a 5- or 6-fold increase, will make a huge difference. It will make a difference of life and death, a difference to food security, but to all the materials we need as we go on to a post-fossil economy. So it is indeed the most important process, and it's very, very fitting that we as Wageningen University, so much concentrated on life sciences and the forefront of biology, can create an institute that can attract worldwide talent to work on this in an interdisciplinary way, from biochemistry to genetics and beyond. This is indeed, ladies and gentlemen, a very historical moment, and I'm extremely proud that we have been able to define this subject in such a very precise way. We have had a number of projects already in this area. We have a very strong international network, and this will be really the fundamental world-leading institute that works on this. And why this is so important, you will hear from Francesco, who is one of our first, not the first, but one of the first young researchers that will be involved. And do remember, if you only want to remember one thing about photosynthesis, the only resource that's free on this earth is sunlight. Francesco.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Nice view, huh? You can almost feel a nice summer breeze by simply looking at it. Let's get past the first impression, though, as something wonderful is happening inside every bit of green you see there and around you. Every cell of every leaf of every plant is busy performing a spectacular energy conversion. The energy from the sun is being turned into the sugars that power our planet. This is the process of photosynthesis, or building with light. What is happening in all plants is not the same, though. We indeed know that even within the same species, different plants can have higher or lower photosynthesis. This makes perfect sense when you think that nature had millions of years to unleash one of its most powerful forces on photosynthesis, that is, evolution. Many possibilities have been tried throughout these millions of years, and many possible outcomes have been written into the book of nature for photosynthesis. Now, take a moment to imagine what we could do if we had read and deciphered this book in its entirety. We would have all the information on how plants manage to adapt their photosynthesis to different environments. Some of these environments definitely have been more challenging than the others, as the environment of the species I work on. My gray mustard was born around the Mediterranean and had to adapt to its hot, long summers. Evolution made it grow rapidly to win the battle for scarce resources. It's also made it occupy seemingly pointless environments, such as rock cliffs first and roadsides later, to reduce competition with other plant species. It's no wonder that almost everyone considered it just a weed, just a nice nuisance. However, curious researchers picked one of these plants up from a compost pile, almost from garbage, you would say, and observed it had great potential, specifically the potential that comes with extremely high photosynthesis. Now, in nature, high photosynthesis can translate to rapid growth, but years of research tell us that we can use increased photosynthesis to increase the yields of our crops. Let's then take a moment and think what we will be able to do once we know how my gray mustard achieves its high photosynthesis and how other plant species cleverly adapted to increase and improve their photosynthesis under challenging environments. Think of the possibilities we'll have to increase and improve the photosynthesis of our crops. Think of the opportunities we will then have to improve the yields of our crops and produce all of the food that our world will need in the future. It does seem wonderful, doesn't it? Who would have thought that a million-year-old process in a seemingly insignificant plant could hold the answer to the question, how do we feed the world? Now, I and a small group of other researchers have access to technology that a few years ago seemed impossible, allowing us to understand this great book of nature with a depth no one ever could. I'm very happy to be here today on this stage celebrating the fact that many other researchers will be able to join us on this beautiful quest. The time to improve the photosynthesis of our crops, well, is now. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Francesco. Thank you very much, Francesco. And again, I would like to ask you a big applause, not just for our benefactors, but also for the team that I cannot name because of time, that has worked so hard with Francesco and others to make this possible. So thank you all, and this is the beginning of a great future.
Thanks a lot for that. Really a great moment. Thanks a lot, Francesco, for an energetic speech also. And thank you also, of course, but Louise is part of the normal job. So, if it becomes normal to announce 50 million, well, okay. Ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of this 104th Dies Natalis celebration. Thank you all for being with us, both here in the audience and also online. I think we have not closed the debate on education, but we have opened it on the future of education. And we see this also, this theme, as the start of a discussion in our institution on the new vision for education. And we need that new vision also for our new strategic plan. And we will take time for that. We will not rush that. And I think also Professor Van Damme give also enough food for thought for us to further develop that. But I invite you very much, all of you, and also those who are not there, to join in that new debate on a new vision for education, because that is still one of our core tasks. And that comes always together, as we just heard, with research. These are two are always separated. Together, sorry. I think it's definitely time to close this meeting. Thank you all. We go to the reception over there and see you next year, definitely.